Yeah, thank you and good morning. About 2 years ago, the IHS celebrated its 50th anniversary. And this event, together with the necessity to move to another building from the, what we already did, from the 6th to the 8th district, and also changes within the academic landscape, made the Board of Trustees, the Curatorium, the management of the IHS, and also the staff of the IHS to reflect about the overall mission of the IHS. This led to a large strategy process we started last year and came up with a new strategy for the IHS which has been adopted this summer, and I will just talk about the three main elements of this new strategy. The first most important point, I think, is that the new mission statement of the IHS says that the IHS should conduct research in the interest of the public, also Wissenschaft im Dienste der Öffentlichkeit. It shall be an independent social research institute. Second, as many of you know, the disciplinary organization and the disciplinary research orientation of the institute will be transformed into a problem-oriented thematic structure of the house. So in the future, the societal issues, like, and these are just examples, like the future of work or demographic change, health and elderly people, so this will be treated from a multidisciplinary perspective, what means that the departments, the disciplines will still be within the house, so there will be sociology, there will be economics, there will be political science and maybe others which might be necessary for these new problem-oriented thematic units, but we will try to interlink the disciplines much more than it was like in the past. And the third important point is that the disciplinary teaching programs which we ran for the last years, and in the last years mainly on a doctoral level within these three departments, or there were three separate programs, these programs will be stopped, but there will still be training in the future on a pre-doc and a post-doc level, so we will employ junior researchers which will be related to these thematic groups. And instead of guest professors, what we had so far within these three programs, we are planning to have still international fellowships. So this means that we are now in the middle of a process of reorganization, and I hope that this, and I think we all are very positive and optimistic, that this will lead to a new IHS, which will then again be a pioneering institution, like the IHS 50 years ago was within not only the Austrian academic landscape, but also beyond. Thank you.
So, this will be the future, we are going to the past, and we will do kind of a collective oral history in front of you. And I would like to start with the one who came to the Institute as the first in this round, Jürgen Pelikan. And as far as I did my research, he remained for the longest period. And he continued to live in Vienna, so he even had the chance to observe the IHS afterwards. Jürgen.
Thank you so much, Christian, for your question. Before I answer the question, I really would like to thank very heartily the organizers to invite us and to give us a possibility to be united again and talk to each other, because we don't meet every day now, as we did 50 years or 45 years ago, it depends, and I think that's very, very nice opportunity for us. But second, I would have to ask, why us? Because I think you see only one lady and some men, and if you look at the mean age of us. We are, most of us are beyond pension. It's interesting why we were selected. And I think the reason why we were selected is that we represent the golden age of this institution. That's at least my thesis. It's the golden age of this institution, which was in the 70s. But now to your question, of course, we have been asked to answer two questions. How did we come to the institution and what did we think the impact of the institution was? Well, I came there in 1964. I came there first because Leopold Rosenmeier had recommended me, because at that time you needed some recommendation to be there. Then you needed two interviews, interview with the directors. One was very informal with Slavko Zagorov, a Bulgarian statistician. The other one was very particular with Adolf Kotzlik, a very radical economist. And within this interview, I got to argue with him, and he stopped the interview, and I was staying outside, and I nearly passed. I nearly didn't get in, but at that time, Freda von Pavlov, now Freda Meissner-Blau, was the general secretary of the institute, and her diplomatic facilities helped me so that I could become. And then, of course, we had to do an entrance examination, but the examination, of course, was not in social sciences. It was just mathematics and statistics. Second, maybe, why was it interesting to be there as a scholar? You were taken for 2 years. You got some money, at that time, 3,000 shillings, where you could live on, even with a small family. You got a desk there. You had to be there, and you had the really very good opportunity to listen to world eminent sociologists and other social scientists, economists, statisticians, philosophers. You could discuss with them, and for me, actually, it was very important that the institute was more advanced technologically at that time. The institute already had a 1620, while the Institute of Sociology only had a 101, IBM, I think you won't even know what kind of machinery is behind that, but for us it was very important. And of course, a library was developing. That is the one thing. And I stood there and I went through all these discussions, and you see what we just heard about the future. We discussed that already in the 60s and 70s, you see, because it was interesting. The institute was built because Paul Lazarsfeld and Oskar Morgenstern had difficulties to find social scientists in Eastern Europe and in Austria who were trained well enough to go to the United States and get a Ford Fellowship. Yeah, you see, that was the reason. And therefore, at the beginning, the institute was something like an extra tuition for Austrian students, because I think correctly it was thought the universities didn't do their job well enough. And that, of course, was an interesting thing to bring in for not so many scholars, for about 30 scholars of different departments, guest professors from the world. Yeah? And of course, from the beginning, it was a problem how the institute could in a way, integrate research and education. And I'm very optimistic about the new direction now, because there seems to be a very interesting integration. I started there then as a research assistant, an assistant. I tried to do empirical research. Paul Lazarsfeld was very interested in that. You see, his institution was called Bureau of Applied Research. And Morgenstern came from an institution which was Institute of Advanced Studies. And you see, these two conceptions had to be integrated in one way or other. And Lazarsfeld, by a conference in 1967, which was called Applied Sociology, Applied Social Sciences, tried to do something that more research was done there, and our guests were used better. Because you see, you could read Aaron Cicourel before he came to the institute. There were very interesting books, but of course it was a big difference, and we will hear about that, to have the opportunity to discuss with you, Aaron. And that developed. Then for me it was very important that I got the chance to get a Ford Foundation postdoctoral fellowship. I went to Columbia And I came back and became head of this department. And when I, and that's there my relation to the people here begin. You see, I met Hermann Strasser when I was at Columbia, New York, because he was at Fordham at the time. And I thought we had to change a little bit. You see, at the beginning, the institution was very self-selective. Yeah? Of course, guest professors came from outside. The first assistants had been came from outside too, but then all people who get some position came from inside. And I, therefore, for me, it was important to invite Hermann Strasser, somebody from outside who had been in the States as an assistant. And I had the opportunity to invite Aaron as a guest professor. And of course, you see, it was a really privileged situation because you just could decide whom do I want. Today, Parsons, tomorrow, Luhmann, then Cicourel, or maybe Fox Piven, or Guldner. You see, you name it. We just had the possibility to have a program and invite these people, and they came, and we could discuss with them and learn from them. That was a really very spectacular opportunity we had. But in one way, it was a little bit an island in Austria, and their relations to the universities were difficult ones. But I think if I am asked, did the institute have an impact? I think it really has an impact. If you look at this society, you see two of the plenary speakers had been at the Institute of Advanced Studies, not only Karin, but Max Haller. Of course, if you look at the positions which are in sociology, which have been institutionalized in between, but there was an interesting thing. Only some universities in Austria really profited, and that is Vienna, Graz, and Innsbruck. I think we never had very, or the institute never had much influence on Linz or Salzburg or other universities, and that was something we can discuss too, why that is the case, why this thing was taken up by some. And of course, we are asked in a question, how much did it allow us to link to the world? Of course, at the beginning, it was very selective. It was to the US American social sciences, and especially to people who had emigrated from Austria and who hadn't got a chance at the universities to come back, but who got a chance at the Institute of Advanced Studies to come back and to bring their very important research and results to Austria again. But then it opened a little bit, and it never opened really to France, I would say, because Michel Grosier is a French-American sociologist, for example. He was one who was invited. It never opened very much to Scandinavia. Johan Galtung, again, he came, but he's a Norwegian-American sociologist in a way. And but in the time of the 70s, of course, Germany became more important, and we invited Klaus Offe and Frieda Naschold and Hannes Sigrist and a lot of German sociologists as well. So my summary would be, it was a very specific institution, a very privileged one, a real island of learning where you could do your learning, and it had impact at least on the Austrian sociology. And I stop okay. Here.
Thanks, Jürgen. You mentioned Hermann Strasser sitting nearby. You hired him in New York, but he is originally from nearby Salzburg.
I know.
but graduated first at this university in Innsbruck. So tell us your story.
Okay. Also, thank you for inviting me and for inviting us and for inviting friends to present this story of the IAS. I try also to answer these two questions. How did I come to the Institute, and why was the Institute a window, for me, a window to the world, especially to the scientific world. Now, how did I come to the Institute? Jürgen Pelikan mentioned already some aspects. I came to the Institute as a so-called wissenschaftlicher Mitarbeiter, although some described us already then as assistant professors, but only some did that. And before I applied this position, I had undertaken a postgraduate study of sociology at Fordham University in New York with a Fulbright stipend. And this was between 68 and 1971. Before that, I studied economics at the University of Innsbruck here between 61 and 67. And in between, also at the Free University of Berlin, I got doctoral degree here in Innsbruck in 67. And then I met a man here in Innsbruck in several discussion groups, whom you probably still know. It was Kurt Schuschnigg. And Schuschnigg participated in many political discussions, although he was not anymore the strong man of the 1930s, but he also gave lots of advices. He came from the United States back from St. Louis, where he was a professor for political science and law, and he was the one who gave me clear recommendations where to go, what to do in the United States, and what to do afterward. And as Jürgen Pelikan already mentioned, in New York I met him and Helga Novotny a year before. Helga Novotny was just doing her dissertation with Daniel Bell at Columbia, and they introduced me to the Institute for Advanced Studies in Vienna and said what the advantages could be to come to Vienna. And so I was thinking, okay, let's use the fourth year of as a Fulbrighter in the United States and apply for an assistant professorship. And I did that. I got three offers, and I accepted the offer that was the so-called remotest place in order to get to know America better. That was the University of Oklahoma in Norman. And after a few months, they offered me also an associate professorship without a time limit. But we were not ready to stay in the United States. And so the offer from the Institute for Advanced Studies was very welcome. And so we could go back. Also, our first daughter was born in the United States. And when we came, when I came to the Institute in June of 72, I noted immediately two things. The first thing is that you also mentioned already, Jürgen, the elite of economists, of sociologists, of political scientists and methodologists in the social sciences came and went there. And among them were, of course, people like Aaron Cicourel, Paul Feyerabend, Burkhard Holzner, Otis Dudley Duncan, Guldner, Robert Hodge, James Coleman, Ralph Turner, Francis Fox Bevin, and Eric Olin Wright, and Anthony Giddens, John Goldthorpe, Derek Phillips, and so on and so on. And of course also always Niklas Luhmann and Paul Lazarsfeld. The second thing was that I noted immediately there was a strong support of the Institute that came from the city of Vienna, that came from the Ministry of Education and Science, and from the Austrian National Bank. It also came, of course, from the political side in general. But the, on the one hand, the Institute was closely intertwined with such institutions as the Chamber of Commerce and the Chamber of Labor and other ministries. But on the other hand, it had also a critical view of this Austrian networking system. And I can only say that, as Karin Knorr-Cetina said the other day in her key note speech that the IIS was part of the wissenschaftliche Belohnungssystem mit politischen Interventionsmöglichkeiten, as you said. Yes, it was a rewarding system that was individualized, although always connected with political intervention. You could go to a political party and say, could you support that or that or that? And that was always possible. But in contrast to the universities, the institute was, of course, not an imaginized class society consisting of interest groups in contrast, in constant conflict with each other. That was not the, the institute. The individual was in front and not the group or status group when in conflict with each other. The institute's mission was also clear from the very beginning to improve the infrastructure of the social sciences on an empirical and methodological basis according to the American model. And but not only the international and the methodological character was important, but also this constant latent opposition against or to the conservative institutions of Austrian universities. And for some, the IIS was either a think tank or a rote Kaderschmiede, as it was always called, a red elite school. For Paul Lazarsfeld, the mission was necessary in order to solve the Austrian problem, as he called that once. It consisted of reducing the lack of talents, which was caused by the emigration of many intellectuals since 1934, and continued in the 1950s in the direction of the Wirtschaftswunderland Bundesrepublik Deutschland. And in addition, Lazarsfeld also saw the Austrian situation of political parties, as I said already, because they focused mainly on connections, on networks, with the consequence of opposing intellectuals. And so he often said, please don't listen to them, although he once said to me, as we did a study on social inequality, why did you use that word, social inequality? That can be, you know, that could cause lots of critique. And he meant we should use a notion of social stratification because that was more neutral. And just short notes on why the IIS opened for me the window to the world. The first one was teaching and doing research at the institute in small groups of students, which was very motivating and very instructive, as it focused always on actual topics of the development of the Austrian society and always connected with policy advice, especially in the areas of sociology of science, inequality, mobility research, and medical sociology. And so the second aspect why the IIS opened for me the window to the world was, of course, meeting social scientists there from all over the world. And each one of them had to be cared for by one of us, by one of the wissenschaftlichen Mitarbeiter. And most of them stayed for several weeks, not just for a few days in Vienna. And they wanted to not just teach at the institute, but they also wanted to get to know the country and the people, and of course, especially Vienna and its cultural pleasures. And so you can imagine that we as graduates did not feel and did not see ourselves as assistants to professors. No, we saw us rather as assistant professors. We experience an individualization actually of persons, since no status groups were the decision makers. Our self-consciousness consisted of independence and experience. And I actually wanted to make a short note out of my autobiography when I met one of the guest professors, but I don't know whether I can still do that. 2 minutes?
2 minutes? Okay.
2 minutes, yeah.
Two minutes.
No, just that you get an idea what it meant, what it meant to meet these people like Aaron Cicourel or Donny Giddens or John Goldthorpe or Niklas Luhmann. And I described there in this chapter on my Viennese years the meeting with Donny Giddens. I took care of him during his stay in Vienna. Den Besuch von Donny Giddens am IHS im März 1977 werde ich nicht nur deshalb immer in Erinnerung behalten, weil er ein so ausgezeichneter Redner war, meistens ohne Manuskript vortrug, uns durch einen Vergleich der Klassentheorien soziale Ungleichheit besser verstehen ließ und das auch noch beim Gößelheurigen bei uns um die Ecke in Obersankt Veit mit der ganzen IHS-Truppe. Auch den Wochenendausflug mit ihm, meiner Frau und unseren Kindern in die Wachau von Krems nach Melk und zum Stift Göttweig werde ich nie vergessen. Nicht so sehr, weil ich unseren britischen Gast in Erstaunen versetzte, als ich ihm die Geschichte von Richard Löwenherz in Verbindung mit der Burg Dürnstein erzählte. Es gab noch einen ganz anderen Anlass, in dem nicht die Briten via Löwenherz, sondern die Österreicher regelrecht vorgeführt wurden. Wir waren gerade auf der Heimfahrt nach Wien, als wir uns einer Kreuzung näherten, aber ich nicht sicher war, ob ich dann nach links oder nach rechts abbiegen musste. So fuhr ich zunächst auf der rechten Spur und als ich das Straßenschild sah, wechselte ich die Fahrbahn nach links, allerdings war der Markierungsstrich da schon durchgezogen. Also Fahrbahnwechsel nicht gestattet. Als die Ampel auf grün schaltete, sah ich einen Gendarm auf der anderen Straßenseite stehen, der mich sofort herbeiwinkte. Ich blieb stehen, kurbelte die Fensterscheibe runter und empfing nach einem formellen Gruß eine sehr laute Anschuldigung, dass ich mit meinem Verhalten den Verkehr gefährdete und so etwas keinesfalls akzeptabel wäre. Als ich seine Predigt in die Länge zog und immer lauter wurde, begann unser Sohn auf dem Rücksitz zu weinen. Auch Sandra, unsere Tochter Sandra, war nahe dran zu weinen. Dann verlangte der Gendarm meine Papiere. Ich gab sie ihm und kaum hatte er die Vorderseite des Führerscheins gesehen, bemerkte er außerordentlich höflich und im Ton dezent: Herr Doktor, Sie wissen doch, dass man durch das Überfahren einer durchgezogenen Linie andere Verkehrsteilnehmer gefährden kann. Deshalb bitte ich Sie, Herr Doktor, bedenken Sie das beim nächsten Mal, wenn Sie sich einer Kreuzung nähern. Und jetzt wünsche ich Ihnen und Ihren Begleitern eine gute Weiterfahrt. Auf Wiedersehen. Er gab mir die Papiere wieder zurück, ich kurbelte das Fenster wieder hinauf und fuhr davon. Nicht ohne einen kurzen Blick auf Donny Giddens zu werfen, der mich gerade erstaunt, ja geradezu verwirrt anschaute und meinte: What was that? Ja, ich musste ihm gleich gestehen, dass das Österreich war. Der Herr Doktor, den der Gendarm zunächst natürlich nicht hinterm Steuer vermutete, brachte ihn zur Vernunft. Vernunft? Das sicher nicht, denn er hatte nicht verstanden, dass die beste Waffe das Wort sei, auch und vor allem für Polizisten. Jedenfalls eine Lehre fürs Leben, auch für Soziologen wie Anthony Giddens und Hermann Strasser.
Okay, thanks. Yeah. Next is Karin Knorr-Cetina. She talked a little bit on IHS 2 days ago.
So I talked a little bit, and I don't want to repeat things I fully agree with, so I can make it a little shorter. The first question we were asked is, how did I get to the Institute? And on my part, there was really nothing exciting happening, because I was studying at the university, but I was disappointed with the university for various reasons. Some things, for example, I wanted to study biology. The university offered zoology and botany, and it told me to somehow distill biology out of zoology and botany. I knew at the time, as a student even, or as a beginning student, that it didn't seem to work. You know, if you read the Scientific American, for example, that couldn't really be done. Then I was interested in foreign countries, and I started to study anthropology, but they had distantiated themselves from the current times and did it historically, looking at the diffusion of some objects. Now, that was at a time when objects were not popular as they are now, and they did it in the wrong way anyway. So that was a bit disappointing too. And then I was holed up in the library doing my dissertation, and I felt I really had no guidance for it. There was no one there who could tell me. I worked on the just discovered Vladimir Propp's fairy tale theory and tried to apply it to a tribal myth, the Pausana Guaruzuque in South America. And of course, that proved to be not too easy. But there was no way of actually getting guidance on that. So the university was a bit of a disappointment. And I heard about the Institute, and I cannot remember by whom, but it seemed a promise. At that time, the Institute was run by Bruckmann, who was a statistician. But his main accomplishment in regard to the Institute is that he believed in it. And he was very inspirational. He always gave us motivational talks. And some of this might have colored the gossip I heard about the Institute. And I saw that they were recruiting new scholars. And I decided to apply. It seemed like a promise. It seemed like the other world, you know, the other place. The Foucauldian other place, not the university. And I went there and I asked, what do I have to do? And they said an entry exam, for example, but I couldn't find out what that means. So it was an exam, but about what? They didn't tell me. And that was very disconcerting because I didn't know what to learn for it. I wanted to study for it. And until today, I don't know why they asked me which questions and what they actually did with it. At that time, you were not department head. It was Helga Novotny, yeah, who might have had some ideas. I would really like to know how they, because it were not really questions of information. It was questions of all kinds, and they seemed to make no particular coherent sense in relation to the Institute. Anyway, somehow I got in. Why? I don't know. I got in, and that was the... that was the end of the entrance story and the beginning of a new life, I would say. The Institute, I was there not only for the 2 years of scholar, very well scholars and got a stipend, but also then as an assistant professor for another 4 years or 5 years. And during that time, I was exposed to all the, you know, Aaron Cicourel is here and all the others you have mentioned before me. But it was that combination. It was a combination of really more than one thing. It was a combination of coming in with the leaders of the student movements. I knew none of them before. There had been sit-ins and student movements events at the university, and I participated in them and observed them, but I certainly wasn't a student movement leader. But I came in with Eva Kreisky and Peter Kreisky and Marina Fischer and Peter Kowalski, you know, and Silvio Lehmann, who did I forget? A number of others.
Paul Gessler.
Yes. So about half of the people recruited with my generation were student movement leaders, whom I didn't know and knew no one else either. And then the other half were people like me who seemed to have just applied and somehow gotten in. But it was really from day one that one's life changed at the Institute for the reasons Hermann already mentioned. You know, you were suddenly in a relatively egalitarian setting with the department head and whoever else also talking to you all the time, accessible. We had that institution of die Stube, of a cafe, the cafeteria, you know, where we met all day long and stayed. And this is something Bruckmann propagated explicitly. He said, everyone stays here until 11 at night and likes to stay here and work here. It's fantastic. Look at the windows. They are all lighted up still. And it was true. So we met people. I met people from the economics department, Peter Fleissner, for example, and others at the Stube. We talked about all kinds of things at the time. And this ongoing discussion, this sort of, it was a flow, in Cicen Michali's words, it was a flow experience that was generated, a discussion going round and round about certain things. And the intimacy of the contacts, both with the management level and superior higher level at the Institute, but also then with the guest professors, was fantastic. Beside the Stube, we had Annette. Yes. I want to mention the two, you know, bodily, caring to your body, but at the same time allowing you to discuss. I remember discussing with Lazo, I mean, no, not with Lazo, he resided at the Sacher in Berlin, and you had to go there. But
it's the ambassador.
Peter Feierabend, for example, Paul Feierabend, you went with him to Annette, and you discussed for 3 hours. Gudmund Hernes from Norway, you discussed with them for Luhmann, at Annette. We discussed the distinction between a closed system and an open system forever. Luhmann had just discovered closed system theory, going from an open system theory to closed system theory. And these long discussions over coffee, Viennese coffee, I should say, it is not like German coffee, it's not like American coffee, it's real good coffee. And it was stimulating. And we did that all night, and then we also often, in private circles, continued these discussions. I think there were three types of things that were sort of unheard of in Austria. One was, of course, the exposure to our guest professors, and to get to know them in person. And you didn't just feel linked in via social media. You were linked in personally. You got to know the person. They gave you advice. Aaron advised me to go to Berkeley. It was one of the best advices I ever got in my life. I had no idea where I should go in the United States. He advised me to go to Berkeley, and Berkeley was fascinating for me. And so it went. All of them gave you some kind or other of advice. You know, Gudmund Hermans gave me his book, and he said it's a gift. And I was a bit careful with gifts. But he said, a gift is something to pass on. In the next generation, you give your books to someone else. And it was fantastic to learn even such trivial things. That was, of course, a condition where what I said in the beginning when I gave my talk started to take hold. That is, you started to look back at the university as if you were already half outside, because you were related to this new world, which was a global world for me, regardless of the selectiveness of anything outside Austria. You know, that was intellectually exciting, was wonderful. And so you got this linkage to the global world, and you looked back at Austria, and I was sort of halfway out already after 2 or 3 years. But the second thing was the exposure to my student movement colleagues, and that was hard learning. That was hard learning because I was a bystander. I believed in the goals, in the ideas, but it was really not a felt experience for me. So I had no real complaints against my parents. I had a reasonable upbringing, you know? But and now I had to fight them, and I had to learn to do that. And I thought, you know, I became a representative of the students at the institute, and I went to the Wissenschaftsministerium, and I fought with Hertha Firnberg and things like that. But it didn't really come out that much of felt experience, and my student movement colleagues instructed me in what was relevant, what the world was like politically, and what one had to do. Sometimes they went beyond that, and I resented that at the time without articulating it. For example, we were exposed to a lot of mathematical lectures. We were supposed to learn econometrics and this and that. And I, knowing nothing, thought, okay, fine, why not learn that? I mean, it might be interesting. I had no clue what. But then I was sat down in the Stube, and they told me, you know, that really what counted was qualitative research. And quantitative research was positivism. And that was in the time of the struggle against positivism in the European countries. And positivism was out, and you didn't do positivism. So you shouldn't really go to that lecture. It was an epistemic interference. I resented later on too. But, you know, most of the time I was completely unable to argue with them because I wasn't skilled enough. You know, you couldn't argue with Marina Fischer. You were dead before you even started. It was not possible to get an argument in or to get them to listen. However, that was the second thing I learned at the Institute. After I had been at the Institute for several years, and I went to the United States, and I thought, oh my God, now I am in a real competitive world, and I have to somehow survive. And survival was no problem for me. No one ever again argued me down. There was this Freudian Nachträglichkeit. At the Institute, I couldn't accomplish it. I was constantly battling and constantly put down. You know, I wasn't succeeding. I wasn't felicitous in my attempt to tell them something else. But later on, it was a wonderful training, you know, to argue with Searle, for example, in Berkeley, or with others, in, you know, Eleanor Roche and all these wonderful Marcuse, they came to Berkeley. Dreyfus, wonderful Heideggerian scholar, the best in the world, certainly at the time. You know, it was no problem for me to argue with them, and I learned it from the student movement generation, which was on attack and on instructing you what was correct and telling you, giving you a big learning experience, really, as it later looked to me. So the Institute was formative. I don't know whether I would be here now in the position I am if I hadn't been at the Institute, frankly, because the non-exposure to all of that might have kept me in Austria. And of course, this whole detour, now I'm back in Austria. You know, everyone else has made a wonderful career too. So it's not about careers, but it is about the experience you get as you move through three countries, and I wouldn't have wanted to miss that. But it was the Institute that opened that up for me. If in the future it doesn't open that up to young people anymore, because the universities can't, even if they are not as backward-looking as Vienna, University of Vienna was at the time, and it is no longer, and Innsbruck particularly isn't, I see and I understand. Even when that is their mass university, they cannot take care of these things and they cannot give you that exposure. So if the Institute stops doing that, I think it would be a mistake for the Austrian young people and the younger generation. But maybe it will not do that. I'll stop here. There will be other questions, and I have more answers later.
Okay, thanks. So the youngest member of this cohort who came in the latest and stayed for the shortest period is Helmut Kuzmics from Graz. Helmut.
Okay, yeah, I will also try to say why I got to the Institute, what it brought for me, for my intellectual development, how I perceive this place. It was also quite a funny place with more than 70 people, I think, in 3 or 4 departments with economists who played very good football. The sociologists were slightly worse than them. With political scientists who were the worst at all.
Table tennis was very important too.
Table tennis was also very important. Yeah. And also what I remember quite well is that Johann Auner, the keeper of the house, was the chess champion. And he always defeated all other intellectuals at the institute. I got to the institute because I had studied economics in Graz, had done my master's degree in 72 with a master thesis on the theory of wages, and I thought then that sociology would fit me better than economics. I didn't like the style of too much mathematics in economics and so on, and I thought it would be good to broaden my intellectual basis. And it was also the case that you couldn't study sociology outside of Vienna in Austria very well. It was nearly the only place, I think, in these times. And most of my colleagues, actually, in this year of 72, when we passed the entry examination, I think they were not from sociology. They were either they studied German, theater science, or what it is called, I don't know exactly in English, anthropology, and so on. So I think we were kind of founding, not fathers actually, but founding grandsons of the discipline. And it's quite interesting because for all of us it started something as a new, it was a new field of intellectual debate and also fulfillment. What struck me when I came to the institute was the difference between the highly physicalist image of the institute, because it had, I mean, mathematics, empirical social science, this was how it was advertised also. And then I found a quite different style of thinking there. For instance, much system theory, modernization theory, all kinds of theories. Then much critiques of quantitative measurement. And here Aaron comes in, for instance. I profited highly from your course. You gave on the critique of measurement when you referred, I think, to your book on juvenile justice. That was quite interesting, and that it brought some confusion for me as well. The confusion was that you had to, as a very young person I was 23, I had to try to find out what kind of direction would be the adequate sociological direction to take. And it was not easy to find out. So we had the contrast between measurement, with modeling, between modeling, and on the one hand, and on qualitative grand theories on the other hand, and qualitative microsociology in the coming from ethnomethodology and so on. So this was quite confusing. And it was also politically very confusing, because I've never found again in my life so many hostile camps that followed different brands of Marxism, late Marxism, early Marxism, radical Marxism of the Maoist Chinese brand, and so on. So this was really very confusing. And also some gurus who followed Krishnamurti, and this was a place where you could try to find out what your future strategy for life, your intentions to form an intellectually satisfying and morally satisfying life could be. Intellectually, I think I profited most of the difference between the qualitative sociological approach and the discussion with quantitatively orientated theories. I remember quite well the course that Otis W. Duncan gave on path analysis. And he was for me a very honest broker of his discipline, very thorough. And on the other hand, your course which showed us the complexities of meanings of social life, and where it was quite understandable that only a very close qualitatively oriented look at the world could be interesting enough for a sociologist. And later on I tried to bridge these different views of sociology. I think that figurational sociology tries to combine both perspectives also in a historically process-oriented way, and this was where I later then proceeded. But I think without the Institute I would never have been able to follow this position or this to formulate this position and this research strategy. And it led then to my dissertation thesis, where I wrote then about a sociology of knowledge perspective on social statistics. This was then how I tried to combine these different strands. And I think this is something which is still relevant for me today. Well, all in all, I think I profited a lot from the Institute. I found it morally very perplexing and very confusing. Sometimes when I read Hilde Spiel's remembrances of the 30s, I found that not much had changed in the early 70s. You still found very hostile camps, a very Austrian style of coming to terms with that, very much things that separated and did not unite or did not combine to something new. But later, now we live in a time where the hostility towards other approaches has gone. Now we live in a time of anything goes, I would say, nearly. Now it's easy to formulate qualitative research questions without risking indignant looks from persons who do only the number crunching. And but I think it was really an important and stimulating environment for me, and I think I'm still very grateful having experienced that.
Okay, thanks. So now Aaron Cicourel might give the other view from outside on Vienna's Institute, but could you start telling us how it came that you've been invited to Vienna, and why did you accept the invitation to this strange place?
I have no idea how I was invited. No idea whatsoever. All I know is I came, and I was very pleased with the reception. Everybody was very kind, and I have to apologize to everyone here that everybody speaks here in English because of my presence, and I'm very sorry. Meine Deutsch ist schlecht, immer schlecht. But I used to be able to say some things, and I could read some things, especially when Karin was working with me, it's always a struggle. I spend most of my time with Spanish and French, so I'm sorry, doesn't work good. So let me say again that I came to a situation that was totally new, unexpected, and I was more familiar with Germany, where I had already been a number of times, and had spent quite a bit of time lecturing there and meeting different people. So Austria was very different for me. And I can immediately say everybody was very kind, very generous with their help, and I appreciated it very much. Now, I think that for me, what I began to notice personally, that this institute was something that was opening up, I thought, Austria to the world, because I shared an office with Niklas Luhmann, and we got to know each other quite well, and subsequently I got to know him even better at Bielefeld and when Karin was there. But I knew most of the people that had been invited here, frankly, and I thought it was a very unusual range of people. I think very few of them would agree with what I did. In fact, almost none of them, I think. So that was surprised about why I was even invited. And there were some things that I started to think about, maybe that made a difference, I don't know. But I remember asking students sometimes about, have they read Felix Kaufmann? How much have they read of with Alfred Schütz? And I found that people were not really interested in either author. And I found both of them to be especially important. And especially since as a beginning graduate student at Cornell, I met Schütz at his apartment for 2 hours and was amazed and humiliated because I felt I didn't know anything after talking to him for 2 hours. And anyway, I have to say that I had already learned something about the huge impact that Europeans, especially countries like Austria and Germany and France, had on America because of World War II and before that. I don't think Americans understand that. I don't think they appreciate it. I don't think they realize that the science, the social science and humanities that brought, that came from Europe made America a different country because it was nowhere at the time of World War I, or two, I'm sorry, World War II, American science was not even that good, and social science was not that good, and so the Americans don't understand how important that was. Now, so for me, I learned some of this as an undergraduate, frankly, at UCLA, and at that time, I remember being able to take classes. Hans Reichenbach was there, and subsequently, I met Carnap after retiring from Chicago, but Reichenbach had two students who were very unusual, Wesley Salmon and Hillary Putnam. And so I was very fortunate to be able to meet people like that as an undergraduate, because one of my roommates, we had four of us rented a house together, he was a graduate student in philosophy, and he knew everybody there quite well. So I started, and then I knew Reichenbach's daughter, which he didn't treat very well, incidentally. And then, and so I met a number of people that had come from Vienna. The famous musicians, for example, had come to UCLA. And so I became, since my own family were immigrants, I became interested in knowing more about this, the European background. So I tried to read as much as I could. I could read some German okay, I could read French without difficulty, and that's what I started to do. Now, I say all this because I started to learn about, for example, the amazing things that were going on here in Vienna and in Berlin. In Berlin, in the last part of the 19th century, it was an incredible place that was going on. Then I learned from friends, I met von Neumann at the Institute through a friend of mine, a mathematician, who was from Germany, whose mother was a very close friend of Einstein, and he became Einstein's mathematician. And I learned a lot of things from these people about life before they came to America. Now, I also learned from Schütz something about the fact that he never was a student, for example, of Edmund Husserl, because he couldn't go there to study Freiburg, for example. But then I learned that that Husserl spent important time in Vienna, right? And then I learned many things about all these people that had gone to the United States, some of whom returned to Europe. But I think that what impressed me the most was the way in which the Vienna Circle, as it was called in English, how they came to America and obtained the best positions. Phenomenologists got the lowest positions as far as the prestige hierarchy was concerned. So I was curious about this. And then I learned that von Neumann and Abraham Wald both had grown up in Budapest, were close friends. They came to Vienna and they worked for Morgenstern. Now, von Neumann wrote two very important papers on game theory here. And Wald, he generalized them and created something called statistical decision theory, which he introduced at Columbia. It didn't take them long to realize he was an exceptional mathematician, not a statistician, right? Neither one of them was statistics. And then, meantime, von Neumann was doing work that laid the foundations for all of computer science. And so I was amazed that all these people were around in Vienna, for example, and yet they, most of them that were doing some of these things, not most, but at least half, had no university positions. And so it's an amazing place, and I just couldn't understand it. And so I was fortunate when I went to Cornell for my final part of my doctorate. I took a master's at UCLA. There was a very big Wittgenstein group, a very interesting group. So I became very friendly with these people and learned a lot about Wittgenstein there. Some of them used to, when they talked about it, they were students of his at Cambridge. They would lower their voice and they would say on this day, and they would tell you what he lectured on. It was like they were talking about something sacred. Okay, now, all of this background is what, when I came to Vienna, I already had in my mind and was interested. So that's why I found the Institute such an interesting place, right? And I found that this young man at the time was a very important leader, because he really worked very hard. And I remember the other man, this light-haired, I can't remember his name.
Schrödinger, you mean?
Oh, yes. Because then we had this thing for me that I couldn't understand at first, the reds and the blacks, and how they were, you'd see one and then you'd see the other, and I found all this rather curious, okay? But I found that Jürgen, I don't know how he did it, but he really invited some incredible people there. If you leave me out, because I was not well known. Well, I was known in America, but people didn't like what I did. The methodologists particularly in the state, they always get angry, but that's the way it was. And so, but I think that what's important was that Jürgen really was a wonderful colleague, because we could argue about all kinds of things, and we did. But that didn't make any difference. We were still friends. And he and his wife opened their home to me, and I stayed there many times. And it was always a wonderful experience for me to be in a home like that, okay? That's what I found really pleasant about coming to Austria. And then I also was very much concerned with the students. I had some really interesting students, and I've seen a few of them here. And the student that I probably have known the best is Karin Knorr-Cetina, who I really found was someone that needed to be pushed out and to get doing things in a way that was different. So I did everything I could to help her. And I won't go into those details, but she had this first session in the United States. I don't think that it came off as good as I felt it should. So she came back to Europe, all right? And then the next time she went all the way to the top. Now, I think that experiences she talked about at the Institute made a big difference here, especially since it was often so perplexing to her here, right? But in the United States, finally, I remember that I was trying to bring her to San Diego, and I almost succeeded, but I had several people who said, no, we want Bruno Latour. And I said, no, I knew Bruno Latour when he first came to San Diego, and he was working in the Salk Institute, and he didn't know much about research, frankly, but I knew what he was doing, but I was very angry, and I had a big fight. I finally left the Department of Sociology because I was pushing to have Karin come, and it was very angry. It made me very angry. And so I helped start a Department of Cognitive Science. Now, it may sound a little strange, but that's what I did. I helped start that department. I was the second chair of that department. So this kind of background, then, when I always came back to Vienna, I always found it interesting, and I was always interested in the history of the city, because it really had amazing, amazing developments. So my way of coming here today, then, is thinking about it. I felt that it's too bad that more American scholars could not come here more often, and to Germany, and to France, but I remember distinctly that it was often difficult for me to give my lectures here, because I always felt I was talking to a group that had already been brainwashed by Americans that had come before, or English or whatever, because I think that all the good things that came to America also became Americanized. And I don't think that's always a good thing at all. On the contrary, I think it was a bad thing that had happened, because it became more rigid. So I think that one of the things that I was reminded of this by a book that Hermann Strasser gave me today about the social constraints that sociologists live under but never think about. Right? And this is an interesting problem for me, because Americans don't realize how much of their present domination is due to the fact they had this big help from Europe, and they don't want to recognize this, because it's a very narcissistic viewpoint, I think, an unfortunate one. But I think that it remains that the American concept of democracy has become something very different from all the big writings that started the country. And one of the reasons is that Americans have a very poor memory of how slavery started in the United States, and how racism started, and that when they look to Europe and point to racism, they overlook the fact that in the United States, the racism started the first day the first English person landed in the country. And it never changed, frankly. It has not changed. It's gotten better in one sense, but a legal sense. In a social sense, it's not really better. So I always feel then that coming here, it's not that things have changed so greatly in Europe, but I would say that there's much more for me, it's a kind of a feeling, but at the same time, I defend some aspects of America, but at the same time, I don't think that people understand how different the country is. It's an incredibly different country by regions. It is so big, and you have to live, and I grew up starting in Atlanta, Georgia, and I had a black nanny who used to take care of me. And I met that woman again, right, when I was 18 years old, and I moved back to Atlanta to see my mother's side of the family. And I was shocked to see this woman, because a cousin of mine told her, and my mother had told me to meet her. And so I was walking down the street, and we see this woman working in the yard, and my cousin Max said, look who that is. I didn't know who it was. She comes over, and he says, this, in his southern accent, he said, this name Cicourel, like that. He was, okay, that's how he talked. He said, and she came running over. She was crying. She hugged me and kissed me and kept hugging and kissing me, and I couldn't understand who this person was. And then she told me, and then I realized. Now, this is a part of the South in America that people don't understand, including the Southerners. But I learned to see it differently growing up in Los Angeles when I was almost 6 years old, where I went to school. They had Korean, Japanese who were taken out and put in a concentration camp. And we had African American, we had Latinos. So I went to Atlanta, Georgia, and all the way after El Paso, Texas, it was totally segregated, separate drinking fountains. This was 1946, separate toilets, separate restaurants, separate everything, okay? So this is something that Americans don't know about. They don't learn this history well. They get it a little bit in the newsreel, but they don't get it in detail. So I say opening up then America, for me, was something I learned about, again, seeing how in Austria I felt it was opening up again. And I felt that the Institute was very important for helping its part in doing that. And so I must say I have always very fond memories of my visits to Austria. I have never forgotten the negative parts any more than I forget the negative parts in my country. But I think that's something you have to live with and gradually accommodate to. But I think that I felt that I learned a lot from my students here. They were always very sincere, they were always eager to learn, and I was always very pleased to be able to help because they were so eager to learn.
Okay, thanks. There are 15 minutes left. Does anyone want to add?
Yeah,
Jürgen?
Maybe a little bit. I think one thing is interesting how different people here have experienced the political situation. You see, for me, it was quite different. For me, the Institute of Advanced Studies was one of the few places where people from different lager in Austria came together and, like in a melting pot, had to live together. Usually they were separated. They were in the Arbeiterkammer or somewhere else, and or in the universities, which were more conservative. But here these people came together, and I think it was not at the beginning, but very early, there was a professional selection process, and it didn't matter what political conviction you had. Yeah, there was a formal, you didn't know what questions and why, but there was some formal mechanisms, and it didn't matter who you were, you could come in. And, but then, of course, you had, but concerning Karin's experiences, you see, this experience had been as bad when you had been at the university at that time. Yes. Remembering what happened in lectures at the university, I think aggressiveness was much more open and much Absolutely. More direct than at the Institute of Advanced Studies. Yeah?
Yes.
Of course, for me, it was quite, many things were quite different. I was privileged. I didn't start at a university in Austria. I started at the Free University in Berlin. My first teacher was Renate Mainz when she just came back from the States. My other teacher was Joachim Lieber, who was the editor of the West German Marx edition. Yeah. Then I went to Austria. I worked with Rosenmeier. I saw it's very important, a small group. You can have teamwork. You can do research as a student. Then I went to the London School of Economics and had Tom Bottomore and others and to see how other people, yeah? And then I went to Hamburg to study with, because I was interested in social psychology, with Hofstetter, and then I came back to Vienna. So for me, you see, it was not so much opening because I had experienced privileged situations before, but I liked, of course, the privilege I had. And of course, political, it was easy for me because I was friends with all these people. And as you may know, challenging Marina Fischer as my wife, so it's not a problem for me to talk with Marina and to convince her of things like that. You will remember, we had a very difficult situation selecting assistants at that time. Yeah? But I won't go into that here. But that really was very, very hard. That's the one thing. I think it was a politically interesting place, and of course, we had to, the thing which did work in the 70s was opening up to politics, yeah? And you see, you didn't have to be a party member, you had to have contacts to a ministry, to somebody who had money, yeah? And then you could get a project, yeah? And for me, it was very important because coming more from the Rosenmeier and Lazarsfeld tradition, I wanted to do research. I didn't want to, of course, it was very nice to listen to geniuses and talk to them, but you see, just learning and not own production of knowledge, I think that's not very interesting for a scientist. I want to do something, and the institute, and therefore I tried to open the institute in that direction that we could do that. Yeah? And I myself was all the time very much concerned with the structure of the institute, how to relate education and research, and the other really important thing, interdisciplinarity. You see, we had different departments. Of course, I could go, and I did, to Morgenstern's lectures and others, but there was no, and of course you could do it in the Stube and so, but there was no real, what they are now trying, I hear, no real interdisciplinary research working on topics together, yeah? And I think that was something where the institute was not using the potential it had, yeah? The universities were not doing it, and IHS was not doing it as well, and I thought that really was a problem. Therefore, I'm very happy now that it will go into this direction. Just these two comments.
Okay.
I think I agree. I also didn't mean to say that this experience with the student movement leaders was negative. It was not at all at the time. I just meant to say I always was humiliated and lost the battles. So that was, but that was very...
Knowing you now, I cannot imagine how that happened, Karin. Yeah.
Well, you taught me. And then the other thing you mentioned is, I think that was very useful for me, to learn that you had to argue, and you didn't have to stop arguing, could go on. But I also want to support what you said, that we learn to do research. Yeah. I came from the university with all kinds of knowledge of statistics, but then I was supposed to say what is X and what is Y on a computer, and I started thinking, do I know that? What do I actually mean? So to actually learn to do research for us as students at the Institute from you and from whoever we collaborated with before Helga Novotny, that was extremely important. Just to support.
I think we should not forget that we were part of the Austrian society, and this Austrian society was the great coalition too, and the great coalition was part in our department of sociology as well, and Karin and I, not Jürgen and I, Karin and I was part of the non-fractionate part.
And Jörg Zilian and others.
And Marina Fischer and Jürgen were part of the fraktionierte, von der fraktionierten Teil des Departments, wir von der nicht fraktionierten. And there were many discussions going on, and even, lasting, many hours, but I would always emphasize that we did not feel to be assistants of a professor or of Mr. The chief bookman or something. We were individualized persons in a very, interesting, under very interesting circumstances, being able to do, to teach, to do research, to have contacts, because our own mission was to do applied research, and I think that was really the main point for what this meant for the window to the outside. We were able to look out to society and beyond Austrian borders. You know, it was already a continuing life that started at the institute. The institute was a bridge to the world, because these contacts, scientific contacts, and the friendships that developed had consequences over many years. If I just remember, Bill Hodge, for example, he was the main mobility research in the practically in the world, and we did develop this status inconsistency theory and did some studies on that, organized a conference later on with the IHS and in Duisburg. Or with Eric Olin Wright, we started discussing at the Institute this class structure. Of course, he from a neo-Marxist point of view, others were criticizing him. Yeah, we developed then later on in Germany a big project on class structures and class consciousness. In Germany, part of an international comparative study. And all those things with consequences for publications, for projects, for conferences, and of course, each of us at the Institute was then, thinking or contemplating what will be my view of the career. Habilitation was then, for me, important, and I could then easily manage that. And the first I applied at, for professorships. Of course, in Austria, most positions at the universities were occupied by young, fairly young people. So you had to look beyond the borders, and I looked to Germany because I wanted to do justice to my wife, because she had to bear 6 years in Germany as a Bif Kinesarin. She was a Bif Kinesarin, so I thought it is only fair to go to Germany for a few years, but out of the few years were a few decades.
Okay. Would you like? No? No. This political fighting stopped sometimes.
No, it could go on now, you see. I would tell him the bourgeois class always thinks it's not a faction, you see. And it's just having objective interests, but of course they have specific interests, even if they are not a fraction. Yeah? And there were different interests in this IHS as well.
Let the audience ask.
Yeah. Okay, people in the audience want to join. Andrea, yeah, 1, 2, 3.
It was very nice to hear you, and it was very interesting. But I think it's the past.
Yes.
Ich spreche auf Deutsch weiter, ich tue mir leichter damit, entschuldigen Sie. Zu meiner Zeit, als ich studiert habe, war das schon nicht mehr so. Also ich habe das Magisterium vor 30 Jahren abgeschlossen als Neustudentin, ich möchte gern dissertieren. Würde es wahrscheinlich gut sein, wenn es wieder solche Strukturen gäbe, vor allem für den wissenschaftlichen Nachwuchs. Und ich frage mich, wie das wieder gefunden werden kann und ja, wie man da anschließen kann an die Vergangenheit. Danke.
Okay, Max.
Okay, I've been a colleague of most of you for quite some years. I've just two observations confirming your view, so adding and two a little bit different perspectives. I think one important point that the Institute was that we as assistants were very independent. We had to make research, Hermann Strasser has mentioned now. And I think that was a very good situation. It was expected that you made proposals, but you were not on a big constraint as now maybe young researchers are. So if they have no project, they are not deployed. The second point is really my experience was particular American professors were very encouraging and they liked that attitude. I give an example, I was at the Sociology Institute was also a Swiss professor, Robert Reichert, who was a very nice person, very bright, but he didn't write much. And I made with three colleagues a survey among all directors of Viennese theaters, from Burgtheater downwards. And we had a very good set of data and we told him, well, we should write a paper. And he said, well, I don't know, you must work more on that. So no paper came out. At the Institute of Advanced Studies, when Aaron Cicourel was there, we worked on the project Social Stratification in Austria. And as part of that, I wrote a paper in English, Marriage, Women and Social Stratification, arguing that we must also consider women as a part of the stratification of family. And I gave it to you, Aaron, and you said, well, Max, it's a good paper. Send it to the American Journal of Sociology. I did it. They rejected first, but later they printed it. So I liked that attitude very much. Two critical comments. I listening on this, I feel the Institute for Advanced was a paradise which has disappeared. Yeah. Some mentioned that there are also heavy conflicts there, and I think they were important. There were many conflicts between the staff and the directors. They were useful for the staff. We confirmed that solidarity was increased. For instance, in 1979, my last year assistant, there was a salary increase for the assistants in economics and business administration, but not sociology, political science. So I went to the director and said, why is that so? He said, well, that's the way, we give no argument. I left the institute half a year later, not because of that.
Okay. Thanks.
But we had also, Jürgen, you mentioned it, more serious conflicts within the staff with the appointment of new assistants. I will not go into that. That's past time, but no problem. Last point, the influence of political parties I did not feel so much that they had some direct influence. And Hermann mentioned that Lazarus felt advised us not to use class or inequality. I have another remembrance. We had a meeting with Lazarsfeld and he had read our exposé for this project certification. And I remember very well his face became full of Stirnrunzeln and he said, well, it's no clear hypothesis. It's like a fishing expedition. So he really asked us to look for concrete hypotheses and so on. And I think that was a good scientific advice. Just for the future of the Swan studies, I think it would be a very big loss if there was no more teaching. I spent two times a period at the Wissenschaftszentrum für Sozialforschung in Berlin. It's an excellent institute, but you enter in the morning in a big door and you are inside all the day like in a monastery. So I like it much more in Graz University along my door. Students are passing, colleagues and so on. I think students are a very essential part of a scientific institution. I hope that that will be the case also in the next institute.
Andrea, Flora, first row.
Thank you all very much for sharing your memories and recollections. That was really very, very interesting. And I also wanted to follow up on the comment given the current process of restructuring of the Institute of Advanced Studies, which advice would you give to the institute, drawing from your experience in the 1970s? The situation has changed, the financial situation is different now, but maybe there are some things where you say this was really important for creating this intellectual and inspiring environment, and that some things might even be possible to realize with on a lower financial basis. And I would want to ask you for your advice.
I'm not sure whether you are familiar with the present situation at the IHS. There has been an external expert committee of three people who made the recommendations which Beate Littig mentioned earlier. My impression is it's done and they won't take any suggestions, but if there are some around.
Well, you see, the real problem of the Institute all the time was the fight of economics and the other social sciences. Economics was very well established. If you look at the homepage now of the Institute, it says the most important Institute of Wirtschaftsforschung. That's the way it presents itself, the Institute. But you see, you have to look back, wer zahlt schafft an. The money for a very long time came from the Ministry of Research and Bildung. Now the money comes from the Ministry of Finance only. Yeah? And that really makes a difference. Yeah? And it was very, again, a sociologist, Höllinger, who is a transitional director, he really was able to save the Institute in the way, and it's a very difficult thing to calm down the financial department and to give enough importance to the other ones. That was very, very difficult. And people told me when I said to them, why do you present yourself that way? They said, we have to do that because we don't want to irritate the Ministry of Finances. And they have the say now. Yeah? And so you see, but one had to go now into things concerning the directors and what kind of collisions the last directors has had with which finance ministers and what kind of influences were put from outside. Therefore, it very much belongs to the curatorium, who is represented there, who pays the money, and what the mission is. Yeah? And I think we can't intervene in that, unfortunately. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, it's 1 minute past half, and there is another session, or another talk, after this panel.
One sentence, important for closing. Imagine then in June 1977 where the Austrian Sociological Congress took place. Of course in Vienna at the Institute for Advanced Studies. With of course Firnberg as a keynote
address.
speaker okay. And Uta Gerhard. I think great appreciation, I can only say.
Okay.
Ich wollte nur zum Abschluss nochmal Danke sagen an Herrn Staubmann, dass er das hier organisiert hat. Fantastische Organisation, fantastische Gelegenheit hier. Man müsste es auswerten und weiter darüber reden. Aber ich habe noch nie, ich habe ein paar österreichische Soziologie-Kongresse erlebt. Das war so in meiner Erfahrung der beste. Herzlichen Dank, dass Sie das gemacht haben. Ja, ja. Okay.